Hi Bhargavi, welcome. Welcome everybody. So this is Ramanuj from LawSeco, and today we are talking about a very interesting topic, which is coaching and how coaching can help in education and how you can use coaching in your life to get ahead. So welcome. Let's welcome Bhargavi. Bhargavi is a law graduate from 2013. From National Law School, Bangalore. After that, she had a very interesting career trajectory. She currently works as a trainer and coach, professional coach. And let's learn from her more about her. So, Bhargavi, why don't you introduce yourself a little and share your career journey so far so people have a background about it.
Hi, everybody. Nice to be here. Thanks, Ramanuj. Thank you for having me over. After graduating in 2013 from NLS, I think my inclination has always been towards experiential education. So I joined an experiential learning startup. And since then, I've been doing research in human rights education, which is an interdisciplinary field. And the idea being, how is human rights taught in a lived way? Because human rights is a lived experience subject, right? You can't be reading books about it. So that was my research was around that. And from there, I think I, having been always curious about how the mind works and how we learn, so I did my certification in something called neuro-linguistic programming, which is a way of reading the mind and understanding how we think and how we do and how our behavior is governed by certain patterns that are underlying, which we can't always see. And that's where I think my coaching career started about 6 years. Experiential education. So here we work with different kinds of people. I've worked with organizations which are government, which are intergovernmental organizations, international organizations, startups and companies. That's another area. So here we work with groups of people to get them to think about topics and questions which are important for them. So that is a group learning context. And I've also been a coach in a one-to-one, in an individual, as an individual coach, or what I'd call a personal effectiveness or a leadership development coach. So I've been in this field since about 5-6 years, and I continue to be engaged in human rights and topics relating to human rights law. And I parallelly work as a facilitator, trainer, coach. Yeah, is that
great? Great, and you have some background in theater and music as well.
So I train as a Carnatic vocalist. So primarily, I use my voice a lot, and with voice comes also the body. So I've done a whole bunch of courses, residencies in theater, and theater is actually a way of knowing yourself. When if you have to project something, you have to kind of be aware of what's going on inside you to put it out there effectively. So I find that my practice in theater really informs my practice as a trainer, as a facilitator. And what I pick up in training facilitation kind of goes back into my theater practice. So they're kind of very close together.
Right. That is also an interesting area for lawyers, you know, how theater and voice modulation can help in advocacy. But that's a discussion Absolutely. For another day. For today, why don't you start by telling us about what is coaching and how can it help people to achieve their professional goals?
I would say coaching is basically a formal conversation, so we set aside some time and you dedicate and you come there and you show up. And in this conversation, the coach helps you to kind of look within yourself. I think the coach is like a mirror where in this mirror, you can see, okay, who am I today? What are my aspirations? What are my goals? Where do I want to go? Where do I want to be 5 years from now? Where am I right now? And what is coming in the way of my reaching this goal? What are the blocks? What are some of the things I'm not able to do? Why am I not able to do these things, right? And the coach sort of has lived experience, has experience working with many other people in similar areas. So the coach kind of doesn't teach you anything. The coach is not a teacher, right? The coach is not someone who gives gyan, no gyan. The coach only asks questions in a way that's directed towards the coachee, what we call the coachee is the learner, to discover what's within them and to discover where they want to go and what's stopping them, and to also find the answers themselves. So the coach doesn't give any answers, but enables the discovery of that answer within the coachee. So in a nutshell, I think I would say that's what coaching really is. It's about setting a goal and finding out what's the best way to reach it, and then doing it and then going there. The other thing that I would like to add is that the coach holds you accountable. I think that's a very important one. So you set a goal saying, I want to earn so much money by such and such time, or I want to learn this subject matter, I want to know this inside out, or I want to go out there and put up a performance, whatever your goal is. And then the coach, week on week, typically it would be week on week or once in 2 weeks, whatever is it, will come back and say, hey, you committed to this last week. Did you do A, B, C, D things? If you didn't do A, then why didn't you do A? You did B, great. What helped you to do it so well, right? So it's also about taking stock of what you're good at or what you've done well and what you're not doing so well and how to improve on that. So it's also about being accountable regularly so that at the end of it, you're able to achieve your goal. And it's extremely satisfying for the coach and the coachee when the goal is attained, right?
Yes, yeah. Of course. So, you know, in like very interesting perspective that I got while a couple of years back when I was reading this book by a doctor who was a surgeon. And he said that he thought that, okay, if world-class cricketers or world-class tennis players have coaches, then how come world-class surgeons do not have a coach? And he got some other surgeon to come and watch him to give him feedback. It's not that the other surgeon was better than him. That is not the point. It's not that, you know, who's coaching, let's say somebody who's coaching Virat Kohli has to be a better cricketer than Virat Kohli. But
absolutely,
it's just the fact that another person who understands the work that you're doing or not, but basically a third person perspective on what you're doing right and what you're doing wrong. So he said that after he had a coach, basically when other surgeons observed him and started giving him feedback on how he was doing things, he was able to reduce time and effectiveness. And he said that my skills as a surgeon significantly went up because I had coaches. And then it is actually pretty much something that applies across board, that whatever you are doing, if you are drafting agreements, if you are arguing in the court, if you are trying to build your business, if you are whatever you may be doing, you might benefit from having a coach. And somebody who gives you a third-party perspective on what you're doing right, what you're doing wrong, and also where you are, you know. So if you're trying to do something and you're coming short, then why? Where exactly are you coming short? And from my experience, I have had a coach for the last 2 years now, and I have achieved many several milestones. I would give her a lot of credit because, you know, I always have been setting very ambitious targets. And in the end, we have, like, when we set the target, it seems very ambitious. And then over months, we actually achieve those targets. And then even if it takes a little longer, you end up achieving it. Because what happens in my case is that my coach will always tell me that, okay, you are saying that your target is X. Then why are you doing so many things in life which are not connected with X?
Mm-hmm. Right?
If you keep going this way, will you achieve X? And she will always help me to think it through and cut down. Most of the time, in my case at least, it is about cutting down things that I should not be doing if I have a certain target. So most of the time, she would literally force me to think that if this is your goal, then how come you are doing all these other things? And are you spending enough time on your goal? And most of the time we are not aligned, and after the conversations we get aligned, and then I go on to achieve my goals. It's as simple as that. Now,
absolutely.
I feel that, you know, I would want my students in our courses to have access to the same thing, that, you know, there should be some sort of coaching. So, and in that context, we have been speaking with Bhargavi because she's an expert on this and she understands the legal industry as well. And she has been working on education and coaching specifically. So I thought this is a great opportunity for all of us and those who are attending. So if you are pursuing any kind of education or not, even if you're pursuing any kind of personal goal, we can talk about it, that you know what coaches do and how to look for a coach, and what coaching is, what it is not. Maybe some of you someday want to become coaches yourself, or you can introduce coaching in your organization. And by the way, you don't have to be a professional coach to be coaching. You could be somebody who's just introducing coaching as a system in your organization, or follow it as a process of achieving goals. So Vargavi, why don't you share your thoughts on this?
Yeah, sure. Some of the things you talked about are, we have like some words for it, like prioritization is one thing, which is very important in all aspects of life, right? Like if you have a goal and you're doing hundreds of other things which are not directly related to it, and then you wake up after 1 year and say, oh, but I didn't achieve my goal, then it's because you haven't prioritized your goal, or you haven't prioritized actions which are leading up to that goal.
And most of the time it is like that. People say, I have a goal, but it is a goal and it is not achieved, probably because they haven't prioritized.
Absolutely. And sometimes we set a little too unrealistic targets. That's also there. So a coach's job is also to see what is achievable in your field, but also pushing you at the same time, not, you know, keeping you inside the comfort zone, but to say your goal should be challenging, but it shouldn't be like crazy out there that you can't. Right. So to find that balance is also important, and also to break down the goal into milestones, so that you may have a big goal, but you want to see achievement in terms of progress, in terms of a linear milestone journey. Right. So you may say that in 1 month, this is what I want to do. In 2 months, this is what I want to do. 6 months, 1 year. So when you see yourself going through it step by step, like you said, Ramanuj, that eventually you're like, oh, magically one day my goal is achieved and I didn't even realize how it happened. So I think it's also, so these are some of the things a coach does, which is, you know, making it realistic, making it actionable in your own context, at the same time pushing you, helping you prioritize. So in order to do this, I would say that the coachee-coach relationship is quite a sacrosanct one. It's a space which is safe and you can really open up to the coach. And it's completely confidential, the relationship. You can talk about everything. If something else in your life is coming in the way of achieving your goal, just because it's not professional, doesn't mean you can't bring it into the conversation, right? Like maybe something happened in your personal life which is stopping you, but now we want to solve for that. By ignoring it, you're not going to solve for it.
Yeah.
So even those things come in. So that's why like professional coaching does touch upon personal areas to some extent.
Absolutely.
And so that relationship is one of trust, it's one of confidence, it's one of really relying on the other person to show you, like I said, the mirror, right? And another thing you brought up, Ramanuj, very interesting, that the coach is not any better than you, right? The coach is not like someone who's achieved some great things and is coming to...
So, right. So if you are going to be a lawyer, good lawyer, let's say your target is to be a great, say, a trial lawyer, you don't have to find a coach who's a better trial lawyer than you. That is very...
Absolutely. Yeah, exactly. It's somebody understands enough about that industry and just about enough to ask you the right questions. I think that's what makes a good coach. To ask you the right questions to help you navigate the field in your own way, and also understands your personality in a way that can push you in the right direction, nudge you here and there. Just to say like, okay, you might want to align this, maybe ignore this, or like really go for it here. So that would be what a coach would do, I would think. And coming to the education space or people who are learners, right? And isn't that something you touched upon as well? I think having a coach connected with the education that we're having today, in today's world, is quite crucial. And I would like to take a moment to also just talk about what kind of world we're in right now and what kind of world we're learning in, right? As learners, all of us are learners, I think. All of us are continuously engaging in some kind of learning or the other, whether it's in a college or whether it's through online e-learning or other kinds of learning, right? I think it's a crazy world right now. It's really crazy, as we know, especially today, more than any other day with all the virus and everything going around. I think it's a definition of a VUCA world. I'm not sure if all of you know about what a VUCA world is, but I really like the definition. It's a VUCA, that's volatile. It's a volatile world. It's uncertain, it's complex, and it's ambiguous. So And so there's a lot of things we're dealing with. There's information coming at us all the time. We are constantly being pulled towards different things that we, oh, got to learn about this, got to know about that, got to do this. Some 10,000 actionable things that are there in our day, and constantly being distracted with social media, Facebook, Instagram, this putting ourselves out there. There's so much going on. And in this kind of a world, to be clear about my intention as a human being, as a person, where do I want to go? Personally, myself, you know, there's 1,000 things happening around me. And to say, this is what I want, first of all, to get that clarity, right? And then to say, now that I know what that is, I'm going to really walk on that path. I'm going to really go towards that. I think a coach, for me, at least in my experience, and I've had a coach too, I have a coach, is it's just to sort out the clutter and to pause and just to say, you know, like how we are now being forced by this coronavirus to pause and slow down a little bit and really take stock and look around you, look at the trees, look at the sky, look at yourself. Like that, I think a coach is a regular pause. Every once in a while, every once in 2 weeks, you schedule a 1 hour to pause and to think and to pause and to look at yourself and to pause and to say, okay, where am I going? Who am I? Am I heading in the right direction? So, in that context, and particularly when we're learning and we're learning for something, right? We're not just learning just like that. I mean, we might be learning just like that. Even that something is driving us to learn that thing. Like if somebody is learning about criminal litigation, it's for a purpose that you're learning about criminal litigation. Maybe you feel like you really want to contribute towards lessening crime in the world, or you stand for justice, or you just enjoy the game of playing the game in court, like whatever your drive is. But we often lose that connection with our purpose. When we start learning something, we lose that connection with why did I start doing this in the first place? So I think coaching can also help you put things in perspective regularly and keep you in touch with your reasons for why you're doing something and what you set your mind to your intentions and to your method and your process. It's to connect all of this and for you to holistically see it regularly. Time after time, like every once in a couple of weeks or once in a week. So for me, I mean, that's what coaching really like has made a big impact on my life. And I see that it has an impact on a lot of people who I work with. So yeah, I think more than ever, like today, given the context that we live in, and particularly for learners, which are all of us, it's quite an important thing is what I see.
Okay. So one problem that I see in people getting coaching is that it's quite expensive, right? Mm. So it's also because I think this the demand is of such a nature that there are only executives and senior people going for this kind of coaching, and there's not a general demand from like the you know, the students or younger people, etc. There is not so much of a demand for coaching. Coaching is, I mean, somehow it is restricted currently to, you know, people who earn a lot of money, business people, you know, not even all business people, like, you know, business people who are, you know, a software company or startup and like, you know, so that's it's very restricted. So how do you think that people who want, like there's a lot of people asking in the chat, even privately to me also, that if I want to get a coach, how do I get it? So, and the people have different goals. Like somebody saying, I want to become a JAG officer. There are other people who have some other goals for becoming, you know, for having a coach. I know for certain many people would have goals like I want to grow my practice by X. Okay. That I want to take my, currently I'm earning, let's say 50,000 rupees a month. I want to earn 80,000 or 1 lakh, and there would be such goals that people would be having, and all of these can be very much kind of worked out with coaching. But how, like, you know, how are they going to access this? Because if you can tell us a little bit about how cost works and how things work in this space, I think that would help people.
Yeah, you're right. It is a very informal sector so far, I would say.
One thing, before you say more about this, would you explain the difference between coaching and mentorship? That would help, I think.
Coaching and mentorship? Yeah, absolutely. So I would say mentorship is a specialized knowledge giving by somebody who's more experienced in the field, who's maybe lived 20 years more in that field and has achieved certain things which maybe now we all want to achieve. And they have the knowledge, they walk the path, you know, they've done the thing in that specific industry, in that specific domain. And they are giving now information on how to, you know, go about it, or maybe how to, what kind of things to look for in that specific industry. So it's very specific to domain. It's very specific to expertise. That's mentorship. Coaching, on the other hand, is a more general skill. Coaching, like me, who's from a, say, a human rights law background and education background, I will be able to coach. I have, in fact, coached litigating lawyers, right? Or I've coached an executive who is in the compliance segment in an MNC, right? Now, these are, and I've also coached 12th standard students who are writing their board exam next year. So now, how am I able to coach all these different kinds of people? It's I don't have specialized expertise either in compliance or in litigation or in board exams. I mean, I have written the board exams. But the point being that it's, the skill is in asking the right questions, like I said, and I keep coming back to that. It's not about saying, you know, you should talk to A, B, C, D people and you should read textbooks X, Y, Z. And, you know, that's what a mentor would do. A mentor would point you to these kind of things. A coach will simply say, do you need mentorship? Do you have enough information about your industry? Maybe you need to get a mentor for your particular situation, if it applies, right? A coach will point to a mentor if it's needed. A coach will actually help you discover that you need a mentor if you need one, right? And if you don't need one, that's fine. That's also equally okay. So a coach is somebody who is focused on you, and a mentor, I think, is somebody who's focused on the expertise which you might be needing in your work. Is that clear?
Yeah, that makes sense. So basically what I get is that the coach does not need to have expertise in your area where you're trying to excel, but a mentor needs to have, and the coach is basically trying to get a solution from you, whereas the mentor is suggesting a solution to you, right? So the coach works with you for you to come up with the solution and the action plan, right?
Absolutely.
And the coach's expertise is not in the fact that you know, that there is any, that she knows what you should be doing, but she is able to make you figure out what you should be doing by asking you the right questions and prodding you in the right direction in a logical manner. So that makes sense, right? Okay. So, and how is it different from, let's say, a manager telling, managers in a company also sometimes coaches, or there are coaching centers I can think of that, you know, people, we call it coaching center for, you know, IIT or CLAT or whatever. So take a moment to remove that confusion too.
Sure. Yeah, in India, we call a lot of, exam prep spaces as coaching centers, right? Like IIT coaching or CLAT coaching. And there's actually a reason why it's called coaching center, because ideally, these are supposed to be places where people nudge you and ask you, like, do you know enough about this topic? Or have you tackled this kind of logical way of answering certain problems? Or how's your timing on these exams? Are you able to do 50 questions in 20 minutes? You know, ideally, they're supposed to be doing that. But I think it's, the reality is quite different, where here, most of the learning centers, I'm going to call them learning centers for this conversation, give you material and then they help you practice and so on, right? When I say coaching and when I say I'm a coach, I'm referring to a very different kind of coaching, which is what we've been talking about so far in this conversation. It's about self-discovery, about thinking about your own life in a deeper, more meaningful way, about personal effectiveness. How effective are you in whatever you want to do? And it's not necessarily restricted to any exam or any, UPSC coaching or CLAT coaching. Right. It's not that.
Can we start to be coaches and learn the methodology ourselves and help our employees or our reportees or our, you know, juniors in the chamber? Is that a possibility?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And that's my dream. I think coaching is such an essential human skill, I would say. Everyone should be a coach, right? There shouldn't be, you need not have to go to some institute and get certified to be a coach. Coaching is essentially listening very carefully to what the other person is saying, trying to get in the other person's shoes and really trying to see, what is this person going through? what do they need right now? What are their fears? What are their aspirations? And how can I, and a genuine compassion for this person to say, I really want to help you, man. Like, I want to help you to do your own thing. And that's a very human, it's a human thing, right? So every manager, in fact, like I coach some managers, and the ideal situation is when the manager becomes a competent coach at the end of my sessions with the manager.
Right.
So actually I coach the manager to become a good coach herself. And so that she can coach her teammates and get the best out of them. The idea of coaching is to get the best out of your coachee, right? To help them attain their goals and for them to really blossom and really attain their aspirations and be their best self at all times. So I would say that we can all be each other's coaches. But the thing is that it has to be a little formal, and it has to be because the sanctity of the relationship has to be maintained, right? So even if a manager is coaching their employees, you may want to set aside 20 minutes of coaching time or half an hour of coaching time. And you might be coaching them in a regular way also. You're deeply listening to them and you're trying to problem solve with them. And that's great. But also just setting out this time really helps them open up, because you're really creating that safe environment where you're formally calling it, hey, let's do a coaching session. So I would really think that coaching is a capacity building initiative we should be all be working on. And coming back to what you asked me earlier, in India, it's still a very nascent field. It's still very few people compared to the population that we have in our country who are coaches and who do coaching. My hope is really that this picks up and people become more aware of why coaching is required and how we can all be coaches in our own area. And you know, you may coach one or two people, and that's fine. But you're adding value to those one or two people, right? And coaches also get coached. So that's another thing. So it's a community, I would say. It's a community, it's a way of life where we're inquiring about each other and helping each other reach our highest potential.
Okay, great. So if you can now talk a little about, say, somebody is pursuing an education course and how can coaching be blended into it? Or in your experience, what have you seen so far? Or like, how can somebody who's pursuing a course benefit from coaching?
Right. So the first step is if a person who's pursuing an education course starts coaching, let's say, then the first step would be to become aware of why you're doing the course. Like, what is the larger goal that this course is connected with? Right? It may be your professional aspiration or your some goal which is connected with your career. That's why you would be doing this professional course, right? This learning course that you're doing, the education course. So to connect it with your purpose, and then to really set milestones, like I said, to see that, okay, now I'm doing this course. Am I getting the best out of it? And how can I get the best out of it? And how can I apply it in my life in a way that my larger professional goal is met? So maybe it's about completing the course. Maybe it's about learning it in a way that it becomes industry applicable. Right? Maybe it's about applying the concepts which I learn in this course in my real life, in my day-to-day life, and to build that bridge. So in the goals of the coaching can be anything. Somebody might come to me and say, hey, I'm pursuing this course on contract drafting. I want to draft the best contracts, and I want to enter the entertainment industry. Maybe that's what they say. They say, I want to work with musicians and artists, and I want to move to Bombay, and that's the direction I want to go in. So then I say, great, is that your goal? But now I'll want to set the goal in a more specific way. So I say, okay, so by when do you want to do this? Who are your clients you want to get, right? What kind of contracts do you want to be drafting? Do you know enough to answer these questions, or do you first need to do some research about the industry that you say you want to enter, right? And how are you going to enter this industry, right? Do you know what are the pay scales over there? Have you spoken to other lawyers in that field? Other entertainment lawyers working in Bombay, right? So these are the kind of questions that I would ask them to help them crystallize their goal better. Then they say, all right, I want to enter this industry in the next 2 years. I want to be able to draft the kind of like contracts, which certain specific types of things. These are the kind of skills that I want to have. I want to be pro artist. I want to ensure that their rights are protected. I want to work with at least two well-known singers in the industry in the next 1 year. So more specific, which is concrete and specific, measurable, time-bound, help them figure out the goal more concretely. And then it's about them working on it and me supporting them by asking for accountability. Right. So then
Once you create a plan, then the plan may change also. As you start doing things, you get more information, you figure out that certain assumptions do not work. Certain assumptions may need to be invented to deal with the situation. So as you get more information, your plan would probably evolve as well. And
absolutely.
And it depends on how many people are involved, how many moving parts are there. So it could be a very complex plan, or a very simple plan, depending on what you are trying to achieve. So sometimes I think coming up with the plan would be an easier part, although that is also a critical part, but actually executing it and navigating through all the difficulties and challenges could be quite a bit of a thing as well.
Yes, that's right. So what I spoke about is the initial few conversations. Then it's about executing on the plan, and the plan will keep changing. It will change because you're not aware of all the variables when you set the goal, right? And once you go knee deep into the field, that's when you'll start gathering so much information about what is the reality out there and what is your capabilities and what skills you already have or don't have. So the plan will keep molding. So the role of the coach would be to creatively problem solve with the coachee, but at the same time, not losing focus of that endpoint, of the goal before which the coaching is being done. And it can be a very simple thing also. Like it may be that I'm not happy in my job and I just want to change my job and I want to have job satisfaction. That's a great goal to have, right?
Sure.
So then the questions would be, what does a great job look like for you? Right? Have you worked with anybody who you feel great working with? How can you find such people to work with? Right? And how much would you like to earn? Do you feel happy with how much you're earning, or how much would you like to earn? And then how would you go about it? So the how, and it's creative problem solving. It's also really accountability, because you have to be acting all the time. You have to do action. You can't just be in the mind and say, yes, our plan hai, hum ye karenge, but actually, on ground, you're just doing your regular things and not doing anything differently.
Most of the time, we see that people come up with the plan. Actually, in our courses, we are able to help people to come up with some sort of a rudimentary plan. But most of the time, what happens is that at some point, they get distracted from the plan. It's just like, people start reading a good book or, and at some point, they just lose steam and they stop reading it. And, they do not finish it. Or even if they read the book, because they wanted certain insights that they wanted to take action on, they don't take action on it eventually. So making a plan and executing is quite a different thing. And anybody who has run any organization or worked in an organization, I think, knows that there are so many plans and very few are actually implemented on the ground. So if you can tell us how the coach helps in implementing.
See, once the coachee sets the goal, it becomes the coach's goal also.
Okay.
Right. So once the coachee sets the goal, it becomes, if I'm the coach, then it becomes my goal. So my success as a coach is determined by your success in implementing that goal.
Okay.
So I am now, as a coach, invested in your achieving your goal.
Okay.
Right. So what I would do is, every time we talk, I'm going to bring your attention back to that goal. And so that is why the regularity of coaching conversations is so important, that we do this regularly, once a week or once in 2 weeks, so that the focus and the attention can keep coming back to that. The plan may keep changing, right? If the aim is I want to earn 1 lakh a month, then how you achieve that, earn that 1 lakh is variable. But of course, we may set on a certain trajectory, a certain path, and say, this is what I'm going to do to achieve it. And I will keep asking, so what happened on that path? What actions did you take this week towards this goal? Or did you forget about the goal itself? Many times that happens, right? We get flooded with work and something else happens in life, and we say, acha, next week or next month, we'll think about it. It's okay, right? So having a coach helps, because the coach is going to keep coming back, but you committed to this and you know why you committed to this. Why is it important for you? It is important for you. That's why you got on a coach, right? And so to bring that back to the forefront of our mind is the main job, I would say, to bring the focus and the attention back is the main purpose of coaching, especially in this world where thousands of things are distracting us and lots of things are happening and we can easily lose focus. So I think that's the main, if I may say, job of a coach. Yeah.
Okay. Do you have any example or any experience or any model that exists anywhere where coaching is made a part of an educational course or an educational institute? I've heard of some courses, but if you know of anything, would be great if you could share something. Or you have also worked in any kind of educational institutes or any...
Right. So I haven't worked directly with an educational institution as a coach. I have coached people who are students who are part of educational institutions, right? But I have or people who are pursuing some kind of like UPSC training, students who are doing that kind of thing. What I do know is educational institutions have it's typically called counselors, where they are present and anybody can go and talk to them if they have a problem. But I, so far, I'm not aware of any systematic coaching program that exists in an educational institution as such. I'm also not too aware of this area. I haven't done my research in it, to be honest. But I haven't heard of any specific ongoing coaching program for students at large. Although I think that's the way we should be moving. I do think there's a need because all students who join now have clear life plans, or they should have clear life plans, because they're going to go out into the industry. And what ends up happening is you get into a college and then you're lost, and jo bhi milta hai kaam aa jata, you join it and then you kind of bumble along, and after some 7-8 years after graduating, you kind of discover this is what I want to do. Instead, if when you're already in college, if you had someone to ask you the right questions, that's about it, then maybe you'll figure it out then and there, right? Yeah, so I think it's a good initiative for universities and colleges and educational institutions to pick up.
Yeah,
if they can implement it. Yeah.
Yeah, in our case in LawSeco, we have been considering. This is how we stumbled on these conversations. That, you know, how do we do it? How can we? We have predetermined that we are going to introduce some sort of coaching in our courses. But yeah, because people who do our courses do it with a particular goal. So it's very important that, you know, we are able to support them in that, in terms of some coaching could do wonders, I think. We have had some questions. Let's see if we can quickly address them. So Anand Narayan is asking, I think professional coaching, mentorship, not the regular coaching as a concept is slightly alien in our country. So fundamentally, the question remains, why do we need coaches? It would be great if you can throw some light on the same. Although he has said that his query is probably addressed by now, but still, if you have anything to say on that, why do we need coaches in our country?
Well, I think one feature of our country is that we are too many people.
Yep.
Right? So we are so many people in any, even if you take any university or college or any industry, there are so many of us that it's easy to kind of go with the herd.
Yeah, it's easy that I think is very critical to notice. There's too much herd mentality and people are going, running towards one thing because somebody else is doing and everybody's moving in. My friend said this, my uncle, this situation. But nobody is thinking that, you know, what do I want in my life? What is important to me? What kind of person am I? What kind of life do I want to live? Do I really want to live the life my uncle lives? Okay,
he's
an engineer, but do I want to be an engineer? Would that satisfy me? So those questions are not at all asked. And I think a coach, especially in terms of career, can make a big difference there. But even in other things as well, I think people really don't consciously work on what kind of person they want to become.
Yeah, and there aren't many spaces in our country, in most education institutions or schools or colleges, where even conversations like this happen, right? Like we just kind of blindly go with the flow or with the herd mentality, like you said. So exactly what you said, to recognize our own individuality, to recognize that I am a unique individual, and we all are unique individuals. We all are different from each other. We have our own strengths, we have our own skills, our aptitudes, our capabilities are different, and our inclinations are different. And where I would thrive would be different from where you would thrive, right? Ramanuj, as like we both did law, but we're in such different spaces and we're thriving in our own spaces. But that's because you have to tap into what is uniquely you and really feed that, give it manure, give it sunlight, give it shade, and develop it into whatever it must become. And I think coaching offers that kind of space for that to happen. And honestly, like individual coaching is not necessary in all circumstances and situations. In universities or educational institutions, group coaching could work equally well, right? And group coaching is a format where you have 10 people sitting in a circle with one facilitator or a coach, what you call a group coach or call a facilitator. Facilitate conversations around similar things. Like how much of my goals are my own, or it's just that I've been fed it and I've internalized it and now I'm going along with it. Am I really happy? Who cares? You know, but what if the coach said, no, it matters. You know, can we take a moment to pause and to really consider it, you know, and then let's put our energies in the right direction that's meant for each one of us. So
okay,
that's one way to look at, answer this question, I would think, that's in our country.
Yes. So if you tell me about a little bit about group coaching and individual coaching, there's a difference really, and how does it work?
Individual coaching versus group coaching?
Yeah.
Individual coaching, I think we've already spoken about it quite a bit. So let me just talk about group coaching directly. In a group coaching context, you would have a certain framework is what I would call it. So if it is, say, maybe it's about, say, giving and taking feedback. That could be the... For example, let's say the purpose of the group coaching conversation is to enable feedback to each other, because we all work together. Maybe we're in the same class or we're in the same team in an organization. And we find that, you know, people are not communicating as well as they could be. So maybe communication, effective communication, or giving and taking feedback is the theme of the session or a few sessions. So then what we would do is design the session in a way that we enable giving and taking feedback effectively. And these are not necessarily all sitting and talking for 1 hour, right? Or 2 hours. It may be a lot of activities. So as a, especially as an arts-based facilitator, and I do a lot of theater and arts-based techniques in my coaching and my facilitation. So it's not just sit down and talk. It's also designed activities which you engage in, either in pairs or in groups of three or in smaller groups of five. And then come back in a larger circle and debrief and say, hey, this is what happened in our group. This is what happened in our group. And these are the insights we got into how we can probably communicate better or how I receive feedback. This is what I learned about myself. And in a larger group, when you share your own learnings, it will resonate with at least a few other people in the group. At least a few other people say, oh, you know what? I learned the same thing about myself. And then you realize that, oh, there's so much to learn from one another. At the same time, furthering whatever the session is meant for. So at the end of the session, people are more equipped to give and take feedback to each other, which they would then go back and try to implement in their lives. So that's how group coaching works. You start with a theme and then you build on it.
Okay. So if you can throw some light on how, let's say, if people want to bring more coaching into their life. Okay, so what could they do for that? Like, you know, if they want to know more about coaching, where could they go? Or if they want to bring more aspects of coaching in their daily lives, you know, where could they possibly apply it? And where could they find coaching? If you can throw some light on that.
So there are a few different questions you're asking me here. Let me start with how do they find out more about coaching? I think there's a lot of information online. If you just type leadership coaching or personal effectiveness coaching or just coaching and self-development, you'll find a lot of literature that you can read about how coaching is done. There are also many different forms of coaching. There are different frameworks that different people follow. Like I am, for instance, trained in something called neuro-linguistic programming. So NLP is one more modality of coaching. So if you want to go deeper into understanding the different modalities, all this information is available online. there are also training institutes and coaching institutions that certify you as a coach. So that's another resource that one can look into. I think the way to find a coach for yourself is, honestly, it's in our country right now, it's quite hard. That's what I would say. When I was looking for a coach for myself, it's quite tough to find a good coach because you don't know. So I think largely through informal networks, maybe people can ask you, people can ask me, I can put whoever in touch with the coaches that I know. That's one way to do it. So far for me, that's how it's worked. Also, a coach is someone you need to have a personal connection with. I mean, you need to have a trusted, safe space, right? So if you get to know of a coach through someone you know, the likelihood of you trusting that person is higher. So I would think that the entire coaching industry kind of works on a word of mouth and a trust basis, not so much like a directory where coaches are listed and then you call them. But it doesn't really work that way. I don't think anywhere in the world it works like that. But also these coaching federations where you can approach. But again, how do you pick the coach? It's always better to go through someone you know. That's my honest reply. I don't know any other way to do it at the moment in our country.
If you can talk about the costs involved a little, what could be the range? Or I know, of course, everybody will have a different pricing mechanism, but how does it work in your experience? Or if you can give people an idea.
Yeah, so, well, executive coaching is a very different bracket. So when you coach organizations or leaders of organizations, CEOs, or even managerial coaching, so you coach managers of teams, the hourly rate is anywhere between, I would say, 6,000 to 8,000 per session, right? And often it's like in a package. So maybe you do it for 3 months, 6 months, ideally 6 months. Then you'd work out a rate, which is certain discount and so forth. And you might be doing coaching once in 2 weeks, or once in 10 days. So maybe three times a month is kind of, sometimes it's even once a week initially. Maybe you start once a week. For the first 2-3 months, once you get it going, and then you may switch to once in 2 weeks. That's kind of typically what the pattern is like. With students, so I also coach students, like I said, and my aim in life is to do more and more of student coaching, because I feel like that's a huge gap in our country. There are very few coaches who are there for students, and it's very important that students get as much of this service, because it's just a very useful service for anyone, right? And students more than anyone else, because they are the ones who are going to be the leaders like tomorrow. So my direction has been in that way. And so for students, like I personally, me and my colleagues, we work at a rate of around 1500 to 2000 an hour. 1500 being the really the most minimum, but also really it's affordable, and it's like a sliding scale between 1500 to 2500 for students. But I think if it's like if an educational institution is offering it and hires a set of coaches to do it and designs it like a program, it can be much less. Like the cost to the student can be much less. It depends on how we design the program. Honestly, like I think coaches should be open to these kind of things just to reach more people and for everyone to benefit from coaching.
Yeah. So let's say if a school or college or an online education institute like ours, we are thinking of doing this. So what could be your advice, or what could be some potential models in which it could be done?
What would be some potential, sorry?
Some potential models that, you know, if today, say somebody is from a college or a law firm, or somebody who's in a organization in our legal team is part of this, there'll be students. We haven't asked people to introduce themselves, but there will be students from different institutes. So if they want to go back and recommend or introduce something in their organizations, what could they possibly do at the organizational level?
Well, one is, I mean, ideally, I would say like go and get some training as a coach and you be a coach yourself if you're leading an organization, especially, or if you're leading a team. That's ideally the case. But if you want to hire a coach, that's also a really good idea, at least to start with. And well, I would say reach out to people and ask for coaches. Like, do you know a coach? Do you know anybody? And just really ask around. And I'm sure they're bound to find a coach somewhere or the other. I mean, I'm always available. I can suggest people. I have a community of coaches that I work with. And we can always recommend, like, with given the right fit and the context and so on. Another is to look for these coaching federations and these organizations that develop coaches and certify coaches. So to go to, like, ICC is one of them. And to go to them and to look at their website and maybe talk to them and say, hey, we're looking for a coach for our organization. Could you recommend a good coach for this? So they'll have a roster of coaches that they may be able to recommend from. So that's another route.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If you're trying to develop a program for a large number of students, then it's a different kind of ball game. Then you'll have to design a program, put up a framework to say we'll do 4 sessions or 8 sessions. Maybe start with an 8-session program. And then we have a framework. We say in session one, this is what we'll be working on as coachy. And then maybe get a set of coaches together and everyone follows the same framework to work with a larger group of students. So that's how it can be made scalable, I think. So always coaches usually work with a framework. So even if I'm doing individual coaching, I'll say first 2 sessions are goal setting. Third session will be on planning. 4th session will be improvising the planning. And then 5th session will be specific topics we look for. Like the coachee may say, my communication is very poor. I want to be more confident in, like, communicating better. Then I'll say, okay, session 5, 6, 7 will be on communication. And the internal design will be more granular that I'll develop. But still, there's a framework. There's 1 8-10-session framework. So that's always how we work. So for a larger group of people who are similar, like if all are lawyers or all are students of a certain kind of like for example, people who are enrolled in Law Seco, for instance. And develop a framework and then roll it out is what I would say.
Okay. So I think we are towards the end of our session. I have one more question is about, you know, if we had to create such a program for Indian law students or law schools and law colleges, what could be done? But before that, let's just see if there's any questions. Anybody has any questions? This is the time to put it across. We'll be wrapping up the session soon. So, thank you, Ankita. Ankita said good session. Thanks. So,
thank you.
To you, Bhadu. So, okay. And any other feedback, anything else, and any questions, please share them right away in the chat. Thank you. Okay, please. Yeah. So, what do you think? Like, if we wanted to introduce or thought of, like, you know, doing something with Indian law schools, Indian law colleges around coaching, what could be done possibly?
I think so. I recently attended a conclave called the Future of Justice Education Conclave. It happened in Nirma University a couple of months ago. And I found, so this was about future of justice education, right? So, and these were leaders in the field, so including vice chancellors and different people attending the conclave. And what I found is a lot of openness to this new way of thinking. I think people are more and more waking up to the fact that education, as we've been doing it for the last 70 years, is not really working, right? We can't expect people to read textbooks and come and spew something in the exam and then be thrown out into the world and deal with the industry fresh. And law schools are really waking up to this. So they are looking at experiential learning as an important way to go forward. And if you're talking about experiential learning and in moving in that direction, I think connecting it with the self and looking a little more inward rather than outward. You know, so far we've all been looking outward. That is the industry, mujhe ye karna hai, itna kamana hai, etc., etc. But we're not looking at who am I and how do I fit into this context. So I think law schools are more open than ever now to integrating with this way of thinking, to put the focus back on the student and say, how can we best enable education for the student? So that's I think environment is changing and we're moving towards an openness. So I think now is a good time for law schools to think about even coaching as a supplementary thing to have along with your subjects and other things, to have coaching as a paradigm that's parallelly running with your thing so that all students can really, like, make better choices in life and start early. Start making good choices earlier, rather than waiting for 5-7 years down the line into your professional career and then start thinking about it. Start thinking about it, like, from the get-go. So I think it's a new field and we'll have to work out how to do it. But I think this is the best time to do it.
Great. So we have a Interesting question from Sumit. He's asking, can the coaching thing be useful in the legal arena? Means the general coaching for court arguments by use of NLP and judges' disposition, drafting, research, etc. Okay, so how can coaching be useful in like actually trial advocacy? You have or
I think,
NLP. I can imagine NLP being useful for.
Of course. So I've coached one litigating lawyer in Delhi, and it is very interesting for him. Through the coaching, discovered that his style and his manner and how he interacts with judges shifted quite a lot as the coaching progressed. Right? So he became more self-aware, basically saying that, "Acha, I address things in such and such way, but I think I should be doing it another way." You know, and then he found for himself, and then he tried that other way and it worked for him. So I was very happy, and so was he. So it's because it's ultimately about interpersonal relationships, right? In the courtroom, when you finally, it's you and other lawyers, it's you and the judge. The subject matter and the law, you know, of course, it's of the utmost importance, but communicating it is ultimately what's going to win you that argument or get you that case. So for you to do that, to be aware of yourself and how you operate is equally important. And this is where NLP and where you become aware of your own mental structures and how you make decisions, how you communicate. Coaching can be hugely helpful, I think, for advocates and lawyers, and equally for judges. Yeah, I mean, there's something called unconscious bias training we do. In unconscious bias training, we kind of make the participants aware of all the unconscious biases that they have, right? Whether it's of gender or in terms of caste, or we may say we are so evolved, caste doesn't matter to us, but somewhere it's there. We've grown up in a country which is so heavily ridden by caste. So, and to unearth these things and to become aware. So once you're aware, the next time you're going to make a decision on the basis of something like this, suddenly it's going to hit you. Oh, wow. I'm again going on the same bias, but actually now I'm aware of it. So now I won't do it. You yourself will wake up to that. So for judges, I think things like unconscious bias training is can be very, very useful.
Okay, that's very interesting.
Yeah.
So we have another question, comment from BK Sir. I just want to ask a little query. Is there any specific criteria to judge whether the institute is good or not? Whether it can deliver the best or not? For example, LawSeco is performing their more than best, but not everyone performs the same like LawSeco. Thank you. So how to judge any institute or coach providing coaching? Okay, so I think he's asking how to decide whether the coach is good or the institute is good. I think more relevant that you can explain how to decide who's a good coach and whether you're getting
I think that's a very good question. So always you have to have a good fit with a coach for it to work. It's just like a relationship, right? Like you get along or you don't get along, and it's either helping you or it's not helping you. So I think you're the best judge. You're the best person to know if your coaching relationship is working. Well, the institute, I'm not so sure. I'm going to talk about the coaching relationship here, but he's talking about also whether an institute is doing well. I'm not understanding that part of the question.
Okay, let's stick to coaches for now. Yeah.
Right. So I think you should be able to see a shift in your behavior. That's it. And towards the positive, like something that's enabling change in the right direction, that's enabling you to become more aware and more knowledgeable about yourself. And if you know more, and it may make you uncomfortable, but that's not a reason to say it's a bad coach. You know, if through the discomfort, the coach should work with you through the discomfort, but take you to a place where you feel empowered. You may have to go through a period of discomfort, because when you start realizing things about yourself that you didn't know before, it's bound to be uncomfortable. But you'll pass through that phase and you'll come to a place where your behavior is now shifted and you've made peace and accepted and moved on, moved past your limitation. So I would say you should give a coach maybe at least 2 months, a month to a month at least, if you're doing like just 2 sessions a month, then at least a month. If you're doing 4 sessions a month, then 1 month is enough time for you to get a sense of whether it's working with your coach or not. And if you're able to see higher, greater self-awareness and some shift in your behavior towards the positive, and you're able to move towards your goal, more clearly and there is trust and you feel safe with your coach, then I think it's a green signal. If any of these are not happening, then you may want to step out of the relationship and maybe find another coach.
Okay. So I have got another question, and there's one private question somebody has sent to me privately. I'll tell you. So one question is, how do the student and the coach be more connected and coach able to ascertain whether the student is where the student is lacking? Okay. So this is one question. The other question I have is that why only once a week can we have a coach checking on us every day? That be better.
This is a very, very interesting thing. Well, see, the coach is not doing your work for you, right? The coach is not going to come and do your job. So the coach is here to push you, but you have to go back and do your homework. You have to go and do the work to actually act on it. And to act takes time. How much can you do in a day? Right? Yeah. If you come.
I think it's about accountability. What if the coach checks you every day and puts you straight and puts you? Is that a possibility?
Check on you every day is, some things don't happen in a day. Like some of the actions that you commit to are technical. So the way we design it, like I think it's also been tested over so many years and decades of people having been coaches and coaching, that a best practice is to do it once a week and sometimes even once in 10 days, depending on what field you're in and what you want. So the kind of things you commit to at the end of a coaching conversation will take you about a week, 10 days to achieve, right? You may say, I want to hire someone, or I want to make a list of shortlist some candidates to hire for my company. You're not going to be able to do that in a day. You're going to need at least 3, 4, 5 days to do it, right? Or you may say that I want to complete 2 modules of my course. And when I talk to you, Bhargavi, next week, I will tell you that I have finished 2 modules. You can't finish 2 modules in a day. And my job is not every day to come and say, today, how many hours did you study, right? Or what? How many tests did you give today? That's not my job. My job is to zoom you out and help you see the larger picture and for you to focus and keep this as a priority. And you go and do your work. Because ultimately, the credit goes to you, not to the coach. You're the one doing the work. So, yeah. Right? So you do the work. And at the end of the week, when the coach checks in on you, you should have done it. And that feels good. And it gives you a sense of achievement and accomplishment for you to move ahead. So that's the thing. Yeah.
I have one comment though. Like, you know, recently we started designing one course. It's on, you know, how people can increase their revenue. Okay. Lawyers can increase their income, revenue, etc. So we created 4 modules around customer acquisition, people, and then delivery of services, management of clients and delivery of services. Then there's systems and automation. Now these are 4 different modules, but over time we spread this out, and like, you know, say it's a 6 month thing. So every 45 days people work on one module. Okay. Now, so while working on that, every day we give them one task and one bonus task. Like there's a calendar. It's like you get a calendar right in the beginning. Every day you have, and the tasks are generic. It's not specific to you, right? So
sure. If,
for example, it can be that, okay, you have to build a website or review a website. Okay. Even if you don't have a website, you can build it using certain website builder tools. And if you didn't have a website, now you have a website, okay, which has certain information. And there's a template and everything given to you. But you have to take that action, and there may be some additional action. Now, every day, there's a full calendar of things to do, right? And these, each of the actions, we estimate will take 15 minutes to half an hour, sometimes 1 hour maybe. But we want them to do it every day. And so this is something that we are planning to check back on them, like our customer service will actually check back on them as to whether they did it or not. And so that's something that we are planning to do. So do you think that makes sense? I'm just curious because you mentioned this now. Does it make sense? I mean, it's not even coaching though. Like we're planning it in that way. And every day you take small actions, and over 6 months it add up to something big.
Right. Well, I think I'm kind of sitting on the fence on this one. I feel that some amount of accountability that the learner should have on their own, right? So I mean, I make my task list every morning and then I check it off, and end of the day, I make sure that my task list is done, right? So then I feel like I'm accountable to myself. Now, if I have a third person checking in on me, it depends on the student. I think for some people it might work. For some people it might be overwhelming that, oh, every day being checked in on, maybe feel like surveillance, you know, could be.
They'll be consenting to it. It's not like...
Right, of course. I'm sure there's consent. Yeah, but it might work for some, it might not. The other thing is, it may build some sort of dependency, right? It may be that you're always looking for that call for you to do anything. And if that call doesn't come, then maybe I don't really do it. That's not really making me self-sufficient. That's what I feel. But it may be a good thing to start with. And then once that flow is really built up and then wean it off, that might also be a good
strategy. Maybe that's a great idea. Maybe we do those calls for 10 days and then stop for 10 days and then again check and something like that.
Yeah, maybe. Or then you do it maybe every alternate day and then maybe you do it every once a week.
Taper it off, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Very interesting. Great. So there are some more. There was one more question that we've got. How do coaches figure out what is lacking in the student? One more question from Kushbu. How do we find coaches that are dedicated and guide you? So that I think we generally talked about how to find coaches already.
Yeah. Dedicated and guide you. It's also, you have to try it out. You have to really try the relationship and you have to ascertain for yourself. That's one thing. How can the coach decide where the student is lacking? I wouldn't really call it that. I wouldn't agree with the words used there. I don't think anyone is lacking anything. I think there may be some roadblocks to achieving what you want to achieve.
Why did you not achieve the goal? Like if you said, you will make your website this week, why didn't you make it? The answer could be that, you know, I had too much work in office. Mm-hmm. And if that is the answer, then we have to now figure out, the coach now works with that, you know, okay, why did you have so much work? How many hours, you needed 1 hour or 2 hours, why didn't you have that much also?
Yeah. So that's what I would call, first of all, I think for the coach to identify where are the problem areas, like not what's lacking, but what's coming in the way. Let's put it like that. Coming in the way or like some blocks. So to identify the blocks, first there has to be honesty. You have to be open with the coach about everything, right? And say, this is who I am, you know, you take it. So I think the coach must instill that kind of confidence and safe space with the coachee so that the coachee can open up and be honest. And only when the coachee is honest can the coach really identify the blocks accurately, right? And the second is, even if some people are hesitant in the start, it's the coach's skill to kind of ease them in and to help them open up. So I think there is equal responsibility on both the coach and the coachee to be honest, to create a safe space, to openly discuss whatever there is. And then to determine where the blocks are, and behavior will definitely reveal the blocks, right? Like when you set a goal and you're not able to achieve some parts, naturally the blocks will come out.
Yeah, it becomes very clear where the gap is. So, okay, yeah. There's one more compliment for you, Bhargavi. So Anand Narayan is saying, a perfect session as a part-time teacher mentor for law students and lawyers. This session was very helpful for me. We have to understand that coaching is different from regular teaching, mentorship, and coaching helps to shape the personality of coaching. Great. I think that's a great note to end this session on. We are already past the time. So, okay. Thank you so much, Rajavi, for coming and sharing your insights. I think it was a wonderful session. I learned so much from it, and I'm sure those who attended learned as well. So, thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everybody, for being part of the session.
People are requesting for your number. Can we share it? Or is it
okay? Yeah. Sure. Should I send it to you later and then you can...
Tell me, I'll just type it out here. Or you can type it out here.
I'll just type it here.
In the chat.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great. Okay. So we have...
All right.
So all
Thank you so much. Thanks, Ramanuj.
Have a great day.
You
Bye.
Too.